Thank you very much, Renee. As she said, my name is Michael Block. I'm a surgical consultant. I want to differentiate quickly. I'm not a surgeon. My area of expertise is specifically with the Doppler-guided hemorrhoidal arterial ligation system. That's one of the systems we're going to discuss today as an option that you can discuss with your doctor. But I will be available after the presentation, as I'm sure Dr. Dasher will be for a short period of time, to answer specific questions you might have. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Dr. Dasher, a man whose skills have been honed by over 40 years of surgical experience. He earned his MD from the Medical College of Virginia and completed his internship and residency serving our nation with the Naval Regional Medical Center in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. He continued his work with our nation's troops, serving as the Chief of Surgery at the Naval Regional Medical Center in Puerto Rico, and again as the Chief of Surgery at the Naval Regional Medical Center in Orlando, Florida. He then moved to Florida Hospital Waterman, where over the last 30 years he's worked tirelessly to improve patient care while operating as the Chief of Staff, the Vice Chief of Staff, and the Chief of Surgery. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Dr. Philip Dasher.
It sure is a pleasure to see some of you. Some of you are my old patients and friends, and it's great to see you out there. Yeah, we do have something new, and that's the reason we're talking to you today. And we're going to go through a few slides and just gradually get into it, give you an idea of what your options are, because now you have a lot of options as to what can be done for your discomfort, from just medication to the new procedure that we're going to discuss a little bit later.
You should just be able to click it, it'll
know. Okay, now this gives you an idea of what we're going to be talking about. Prevalence of hemorrhoids, it means how many people are affected by it. The causes of hemorrhoidal discomfort, and they say disease, but just keep in mind we're all born with hemorrhoidal veins. We all have those from birth. So I'm not sure it's the disease, but those of you that have been pregnant several times in your lifetime are going to have stretching out of these veins, and they will present as large blue objects that you might notice. They may come out when you defecate, and sometimes they go out and stay out. Sometimes they go back in. Sometimes you have to push them in. But anyway, that's hemorrhoids. But don't get the idea that it's really a disease. It's a malady, but I don't think I would call it a definite disease. We're going to go over treatment options and questions. This screen just discusses that hemorrhoids are felt, but some people are a little bit self-conscious about it, don't want to talk about hemorrhoids. And sometimes it takes a while for you to come in and see us. Prevalence of hemorrhoids. It's stating that those of us that are over 50 have a little higher prevalence. Well, sure, because the rectum is used every day or sometimes more than once a day, and usage over the years causes these veins to stretch out, and that will certainly cause discomfort. Millions of people are affected, as this thing says. A lot of hospital admissions, big cost to our government, and since we're running out of money, we got to look for some other way to deal with this. Ambulatory care visits, prescriptions, disability, mortality, that's pretty darn rare, but with the band ligation technique, about 1 in 10,000 people do get sepsis from that, and there have been deaths. Very rare, though. Okay, again, on cost estimate, $2 billion in the United States annually. And I guess Medicare is paying a lot of that now. Okay, what are hemorrhoids? I think I just discussed that for you, and I'll answer questions later, but basically they're just dilated veins. Signs and symptoms, as they begin to prolapse and come out, they can bleed, they can get thrombosed, and you can have a good deal of pain. So you may see pain, you may see bleeding, you may see itching. All those are symptoms. Okay, now, key terms to understand. Prolapse, that means when the hemorrhoids actually come from inside out. You feel like your rectum's turning inside out. The dentate line is the line of sensation, which we can point out to you on an anatomic drawing. Hemorrhoidectomy is the surgical removal of hemorrhoids. Band ligation, it can be done in the office where we actually put an instrument. It's very similar what the farmers use to what the farmers use when they castrate animals. It's where we pull the hemorrhoids into a ring and then fire a band around the hemorrhoids, which strangles the hemorrhoids and they fall off in the stool. We have the Doppler-guided instrument, which we will discuss with you. A Doppler is an instrument that detects blood flow. And they can put it on a screen called an oscilloscope, or you can actually hear the blood flow. And when I'm operating with the Doppler, I usually listen for the sound. And when I'm right over it, it's a little disc. When it's right over the artery that I'm interested in, I can hear it. Mucopexy is a way to actually pull hemorrhoids that are kind of lax and they prolapse out, as a way to pull them up to keep them from coming out. Okay, here's some anatomy that you can look at. This is the superior hemorrhoidal artery, and you can see some of the branches that come down. And these branches can be detected with the Doppler. Now, there's a way to grade hemorrhoids. Some patients come in and they're just having minor symptoms such as itching, burning, pain, but nothing's actually coming outside the rectum or anus. That's a grade one. A grade two, it'll prolapse, but then it'll by itself go back in. A three, the hemorrhoid will come out, but you have to put it in yourself. And a four, it'll come out and nobody, even me, can't get them back in. That's a four. And then we have treatment options, medication we can use. Preparation H doesn't do a bad job for minor hemorrhoids. We have more elaborate preparations, which are mixtures of like 6 to 8 different chemicals, and that helps. Most of them have a mild anesthetic, and sometimes they have cortisone in them. And most of these things are readily available over the counter. As the hemorrhoids get worse, then medical therapy will tend to fail. I usually try medical therapy first anyway. Give it a try, because hemorrhoids don't kill you. They just make you miserable. If you can make the patient feel better using medication, it certainly saves them money and saves them having to come in the hospital and have a more aggressive treatment. We do have other gadgets in the office. I have a freeze gun. That's called cryosurgery. I have the band ligator. And I also have the, a lot of people call a laser. It's actually an infrared photocoagulator. It uses infrared energy. It's very much like a laser that is used for early, at least grade 1-2 hemorrhoidal disease. Anything else? Then we're looking at surgical treatment. Okay. Now, surgical evaluation, that's what I do. You come to my office, I take your history, give you a brief physical examination. Most of you that have seen me know about my hemorrhoidal table. It's a little more comfortable than the ones in a general practitioner's office. We have a proper lighting, we have the proper proctoscopes, and we can look at you and diagnose your condition right away, right on the first visit. You may be suffering from rectal bleeding, blood in your stools, constipation. Some people have impactions that have to be removed manually. There can be thrombosis of the hemorrhoids. Thrombosed hemorrhoids are very painful. And those can be drained under local anesthesia right in the office. Now, there are other things that I see. Patients come in and say, "Doc, I've got hemorrhoids." And I'll start to talk to them a little bit. And a lot of these patients don't have hemorrhoids. They have something else. One of the common things that we find other than hemorrhoids that cause discomfort are fissures. Fissures come from having a hard stool where you're straining and pushing and you actually tear the inner lining of the anus. And that is very painful. And sometimes patients can have this painful tear for, I've seen, up to 5 years or so. And a lot of them don't. They just try to tough it out and use a little preparation H, and they get by, but they're miserable. There are ways to take care of that. There's medications that help, and some patients need surgery for that. Skin tags are just dried up hemorrhoids that leave a little extra skin sticking out. They're more of a cosmetic problem than anything else, and they're of no real clinical significance. Some people have itching, swelling, and of course we mentioned prolapse. And here are some of the different things that I mentioned before. Band ligation. Sclerotherapy was widely used in Europe, never really caught on too much in the United States. But that's where you inject very much the same as you do for varicose veins. Sodium moruate, sotradecal, hydrochloride, things like that, hypertonic saline, all those things can be used to sclerotherapy. I prefer the infrared coagulation. That seems to work better for minor hemorrhoidal disease than the sclerotherapy. Surgical excision, if you have a grade 4 hemorrhoid, you're not going to fix that with the PPH. You're not going to fix that with the new procedure either. You need radical surgery for a 4, and we still do that. The PPH is a stapling gun that's useful for prolapsing hemorrhoids. Very useful. And we use that. It's a little bit more painful than the new procedure that you're going to hear about, where we use a Doppler to attack the arteries and where we basically turn off the blood supply to those arteries. And at the same time, do a retroanal repair. That's what the RAR means, where we actually do a lift on the hemorrhoids and keep the keep them from prolapsing. All right, this is an example of band ligation. Doesn't show the instrument, but this is used widely across the United States as well as Europe. Band ligation therapy has been around a long time, and it works. I use it when I think it's appropriate. Here's sclerotherapy, injecting directly into the hemorrhoid, and in the right hands, that will also work. This is the IRC, our infrared coagulator. That black tube is where the light energy is coming from. It's infrared energy. And you go to the base of the hemorrhoid. And I usually put like 3 burns at the base of the hemorrhoid, and that causes the feeding vessels to coagulate and does work for small hemorrhoids. The surgical excision, I think I mentioned, for the really large, difficult hemorrhoids. I still do that when I have to. The PPH stapler is an excellent way to get rid of prolapsing hemorrhoids. Basically, it's an instrument that fires a circular stapling gun and takes a donut of tissue. I'd have to have the instrument in here to really show you how it works, but it works well. Now here's the instrument right here. This is called the PPH instrument. It's made by Ethicon, which is a division of Johnson & Johnson. And as you can see, it takes a donut of tissue up high. We apply it up high above the level of sensation. Okay, now this is what we're getting into now. And this I've done for, I guess, 2.5, almost 3 years now. And it works. We use a Doppler instrument to find this. This is the artery we're looking for. And the Doppler guides me to where I can put a stitch underneath it and just tie it off. I usually apply about 6 sutures, tying off 6 vessels. And the nice thing about it is it does not hurt because we're doing it above the level of sensation. There's no cutting involved, so the risk of bleeding is minimal. So again, we're targeting the blood flow using a Doppler. Okay, this is what the instrument looks like. Over here, you can see a proctoscope, and there's a little window in the proctoscope where a sensor is placed. That's the Doppler sensor. And you can hear the blood flow. You can also see a diagram on this oscilloscope as to what kind of flow you're listening to. Okay, this is an example of a large internal hemorrhoid right there. Glad you don't have one of those, right? Yeah, scary looking. And this is an example of what we do. We're putting little stitches in here, little sutures, being guided by this new instrument. And this is the RAR, rectoanal repair, where we put a start a suture up high, run it all the way down, tie this end to this end, and it pulls everything up. That helps the prolapse. And we do that at the same time. Okay, and this is after we tie that all down, this is what it looks like.
The handle is equipped with three high-performance LEDs, which ensure the light is sufficiently bright at all times to allow the surgeon the best possible vision. A probe containing an integrated ultrasound sensor is attached to the handle. This sensor can also receive the Doppler signal, as well as measure the depth of the arteries. An outer sleeve is placed over the probe. The procedure is very simple. The surgeon works in the area contained by the ligation window. After inserting the Doppler probe all the way into the rectum, the surgeon starts to look for arteries at a depth of 4 to 6 centimeters. Here, careful attention is required. The handle with the probe attached is turned slowly until the first artery is detected and then held in this position. The depth of the artery can now be seen on the display. The strength of the Doppler signal indicates the center of the artery. Ligation can be carried out safely up to a depth of 8 millimeters. A 5/8 needle from AMI is placed into the needle holder and then inserted into the probe. The surgeon then ligates the respective artery through the ligation window into which the mucosa is falling. Due to the rectal blood vessels frequently changing their course, it is vital that the ligature be placed as close as possible to the Doppler ultrasound. If this is not the case, there's a high risk that the artery will be missed. A second stitch usually follows the first. Subsequently, the needle is cut off from the suture, and the two suture ends are knotted together. The result is a figure of 8 knot. Now the handle is turned slowly until the next artery is detected and ligated as before. This continues until one complete rotation has been made and all arteries ligated. In most cases, 5 to 7 arteries will be found. However, this can vary considerably from patient to patient and may also depend on the severity of the hemorrhoids. Subsequently, it is advisable to pull the handle back 1 to 1.5 centimeters and to make a second round of ligations on this plane. The result of these ligations is a reduced blood supply to the hemorrhoidal cushions and hence a far better balance between the inflow and outflow of blood. In time, the hemorrhoidal cushions shrink and the success of the therapy is evident some 6 to 8 weeks after, when they are back to normal. Because the method is based on the principle of reducing the arterial blood supply, HAL is extremely effective in relieving the symptoms of hemorrhoidal disease caused by excessive pressure in the arteries. Bleeding, itching, and pain are treated with great success, regardless of what degree of hemorrhoids. The RAR method is used to treat higher grades of hemorrhoids involving a prolapse, which needs to be repositioned inside the anal canal. The term RAR stands for rectoanal repair, a combination of the HAL method, as previously described, and one or more mucopexies of the prolapsing mucosa. Before executing the mucopexy, it is important to ensure that ligating of the arteries is carried out with similar care and diligence as for the HAL method alone. Only this way can we treat the symptoms of bleeding, itching, and pain successfully and achieve the same results as with HAL. Once all ligations are in place as for the HAL method, we can move on to the next step involving a running suture for each prolapse. Alternatively, the running suture can be placed immediately after the ligation using the same suture material. The mucopexy can also be performed with ease using the AMI HAL Doppler system. The AMI RAR Flexi probes are made up of two components, an inner part that is connected firmly to the handle and an outer sleeve that can be rotated. The handle is moved to the starting position used for ligation. The ligation window, and hence the handle, point to the position requiring treatment. The RAR flexi probe must be inserted into the rectum in such a way that the prolapse can be lifted to maximum effect. As for HAL, AMI's 5/8 HAL needle is inserted into the initial stitch placed. If necessary, the mucosa can be pulled gently into the RAR probe after making the first stitch to allow more proximal placement of the second one. This results in a Z-shaped stitch. By successive turning of the handle, more and more mucosa becomes visible. Proceeding step by step is important to prevent all the mucosa falling into the probe's ligation window at once. Continuing in this fashion, the surgeon places a running suture which ends between 5 and 10 millimeters proximal of the dentate line, still in the pain-free area. The individual stitches of the running suture are placed some 7 to 10 millimeters apart, allowing room for 4 to 5 stitches in total. Once the last stitch has been placed above the dentate line, the needle is cut off and the upper end of the suture material by the initial stitch is then knotted to the distal end of the suture. This causes the prolapse to be pulled up in the direction of the initial stitch, where it is then secured in place with a sliding knot. The number of mucopexies differs from patient to patient, and the surgeon will decide how many are necessary as the operation proceeds. As a general rule, between 2 and 4 running sutures are required. However, it is certainly possible to perform more or even fewer. The RAR precision probe is the second type of RAR probe available. In contrast to the RAR flexi probe, the precision probe has a comb-shaped part designed to standardize the mucopexy. The first part of the operation, the ligation of the arteries, remains the same. To carry out the mucopexy, the outer sleeve is turned in such a way that the comb-shaped part of the probe is positioned directly underneath the sleeve's mucopexy window. Now the probe is inserted rectally, whereby the opening of the sleeve should be positioned where the first mucopexy will be performed. The teeth of the RAR precision probe's comb hold back most of the mucosa, leaving just the spaces between the teeth free to work on. As before, the running suture is now placed from proximal to distal, and care must be taken to place the last stitch far enough proximal of the dentate line so that no pain is experienced postoperatively by the patient. Once the last stitch has been placed, the handle is turned in a clockwise direction to release the suture. Now the prolapse can be lifted as previously described by pushing the sliding knot in the direction of the initial proximal stitch and then securing it. The mucopexy with the RAR precision probe can be carried out at several prolapse positions if necessary. Because the prolapsing hemorrhoidal cushions are secured in place in the rectum, the result of the prolapse treatment is usually visible immediately. The RAR method can thus be considered equally effective for treating the symptoms of hemorrhoids as well as the prolapse. The symptoms by means of the precise ligation and the prolapse by means of the mucopexy. In principle, surgical techniques should be effective, patient-friendly, or in other words, low pain, and result in as few complications as possible. To a great extent, these criteria are filled by the minimally invasive methods HAL and RAR. The following diagram represents an assessment made by AMI regarding the effectiveness, safety, and patient friendliness for the various methods of treatment. It is based partly on the data published in the literature and partly on evaluations made by surgeons who have experience with the HAL and RAR methods. Up until now, the international gold standard for the surgical treatment of high-grade hemorrhoids was the conventional hemorrhoidectomy. The method's safety is described as normal to good. However, as the method is accompanied by quite high pain levels, the relatively low patient acceptance that results presents a considerable handicap. In addition, the wounds take quite some time to heal. This means that in many cases, a return to everyday life is not possible for several weeks. The method is rated particularly high because of the good cure rate for hemorrhoidal prolapse. However, the cure rates for those symptoms related to hemorrhoids, such as bleeding, itching, and pain, are less impressive. Outpatient procedures such as rubber band ligation, which is relatively safe and patient-friendly, display considerably lower cure rates for high-grade hemorrhoids and are therefore only of minor significance in the spectrum of hemorrhoid treatments. The main advantage of the stapling method is its patient-friendliness. However, reports of both intra- and post-operative complications can be found in the literature, some of which were also serious. Therefore, the level of safety is to be considered as lower for this procedure than for others. Results also show the stapling method to be inferior to the gold standard in terms of long-term effectiveness. The re-prolapse rates are significantly higher than for those for the conventional hemorrhoidectomy, while cure rates for the symptoms are lower. Where does the RAR method fit in? The method is minimally invasive and displays excellent results in terms of safety and patient friendliness. Up until now, there have been no reports of serious complications occurring after HAL or RAR, although tens of thousands of patients have been treated with these methods. The very low level of pain allows patients to return to their normal routine very quickly, so the method can also be viewed favorably in economic terms. One criterion for the method's effectiveness is the re-prolapse rate. Here, the RAR method seems to achieve very good results. The publications available to date on the RAR procedure describe success rates in some cases equal to those with the conventional hemorrhoidectomy. A second criterion of no less importance in judging the effectiveness of a method is success in treating the symptoms. Current findings indicate that bleeding, itching, and pain are cured even more successfully with HAL and RAR techniques than with other methods. It is highly likely that this success is due to the decreased blood supply caused by the precise ligation of arteries. All in all, the RAR method shows very good results for all criteria: effectiveness, safety, and patient satisfaction. One further advantage of the HAL and RAR methods, which should not be underestimated, is the fact that the operation can be tailored to suit each individual patient. The result is that all grades of hemorrhoids can be treated effectively. In summary, HAL and RAR are minimally invasive procedures effective in both short and long term for all grades of hemorrhoids.
Okay, so you've seen the hemorrhoid artery ligator using the Doppler technology. You've seen retroanal repair. This slide shows you that 93% or more of patients would recommend this treatment. I've had good success. I'm not sure I can say it was 93%, but I've had probably 80% plus good results. Those that do not get good results always have the option of the open technique or a different technique. So you're not burning any bridges with it. But I've had overall good results, and patients seem to be quite happy with the hemorrhoid artery ligation procedure. So the question is, which procedure do you want? Well, usually that's something that I help you decide. We just want you to know that this technology is available. And if you're suffering from hemorrhoids and have heard horror stories about the old open technique and 6 to 8 weeks or more of healing, bleeding, I understand. And that's why I like this new procedure. Okay, any questions? Do these sutures dissolve? Are they permanent? Like, we used to use silk. They don't dissolve. We used to use cotton years ago. They don't dissolve. But over time, we've developed sutures that dissolve slowly. If you use catgut, actually it's made out of sheep's intestine, they dissolve kind of quickly in 3 weeks. The sutures that we use will stick around for at least a month. Okay, we use a Vicryl suture, which is a polyglycolic acid suture that ties easily. It's easy to work with. Almost as easy for me to tie as silk is. Silk is my favorite. It's a beautiful suture, and we still use that intra-abdominally and bowel where we're not worried about patient comfort. Yeah, I'm what's called a proctologist. Now, I've practiced general surgery for 40 years as well, but I've always been interested in what you're seeing here, proctology. Okay, there are other surgeons that have gone and taken fellowships in colon and rectal surgery and do some proctology, but I've really gotten into proctology and perfected my techniques over the years. No. If you call, the question is, do you need to go to your primary doctor? You should, and that's the way the game is played, but the question is will I see you if you come directly to me? And that's yes. I'll see you. We have to check with Medicare and the insurances, which we do. But yeah, you can come directly to me. I don't mind. that far. It's the question is, how far do you go to get up to where it doesn't hurt? Not very far, less than an inch. And there's an anatomic line there that we know to look for. That's called the dentate line. And below that, it hurts like crazy. Okay, the question is, do you have to go to your doctor every time you have hemorrhoidal discomfort? Can you go out and try these products like Preparation H? Yes, I think so. The cost of medicine, the cost of seeing me, you know, it's hurting your government. You know, we're running out of money. So I have to encourage you to do that. But if you do that and it doesn't help you, feel free to come in. The only other thing I would like to add is that bleeding and rectal irritation sometimes can be a sign of cancer. And if you don't come in and we miss the cancer for a long time, you're dead. Okay? So if you come in early, early diagnosis, let's say it's what we call a squamous cell carcinoma of the anus. Those itch, they burn, sometimes they bleed. I think the first thing you might feel is a little rough area and a little itching. You can come in here and our cancer center can treat you with radiation, no surgery. I mean, you need a biopsy, which we can do with a needle. But you can have a procedure by Dr. Purdon using radiation therapy with no surgery. Doesn't hurt. It's expensive, but it doesn't hurt. And it cures squamous cell carcinoma of the anus. Whereas when I started out 40 years ago, we didn't have that expertise in radiation. And we had to operate on these people. And they'd lose their anus and rectum and have a permanent bag. But we don't, that is not necessary anymore. So early detection is important. Okay, the question is, and I assume you had diverticulitis, not diverticulosis. We all have diverticulosis.
Yeah.
If you're over 50, you've got diverticulosis. And that just means that the colon's getting a little weaker than it used to be. You get these little pouches that form. That's diverticulosis. 10% of the population that has diverticulosis will eventually get an infection. An infection, bacterial infection, in those little pockets. And there's pus in there. Pus sometimes gets outside the bowel, and you might get a little abscess. That's diverticulitis. And is that connected with hemorrhoids? The answer to that is no. No, it's not.
Polyps
are not connected. Well, the question is, we'll make it a second question. Are polyps associated with hemorrhoids? And the answer to that is no. If you get pregnant, oh, I'm sorry, I got to tell you, not used to doing questions more than once. Okay. And it's not about pregnancy, is it? Okay. Can you get hemorrhoids again? Okay. Yes. The answer is yes. Hemorrhoids are veins. Can we remove all the veins? No. Can the veins fill up with more blood if you continue to strain or if you get pregnant or something happens? Yeah, they can come back, but the recurrence rate is very low with this operation, and I endorse it. I think it's a good procedure. And I think if you're over 50, the chance of it coming back, you know, assuming you get a good response initially, if you have the response, you come back in 6 months and there's no hemorrhoids there, then the procedure has worked for you. If you come back in 6 months and you still have hemorrhoids, then I failed you, or the AMI products fail you. And we would consider maybe doing a different procedure the second time. Okay, the question is constipation and bowel impactions, is that going to cause you to get hemorrhoids again? It might. So you want to take medication for that. There's lots of different things that can be done. Most of the family docs are good with that. And there are a lot of good products out on the market. I like Miralax. Miralax used to be a prescription product. Now you can buy it over the counter. And I've used it, it's safe. I think a lot of colorectal surgeons endorse that. And that's what I would recommend most of the time. The question he's asking me, is this a problem? Is internal hemorrhoids a problem that necessitates surgery? Do you have to have surgery? The answer to that is absolutely no. Hemorrhoids are harmless, but they bother some people. When they bother you enough, and you say, gee, doc, I'm just tired of dealing with this. I don't want to deal with the hemorrhoids coming down. I don't want to have to deal with this bleeding. I'm tired of it. Fix me. Then you come to me and I do what you want. But do you have to have it done? No. You can use medication. You can take softeners. You know, there's a lot of things you can do on your own. Okay, so.
I'm not bothered by them at all. Anyway.
Yeah, I generally tell the patients, if you're not bothered by it, leave them alone because it's a harmless thing. But make sure you're getting your checkups. Make sure your family doc has you at least proctoscoped. I think everybody needs their colonoscopies. And a good GI man can generally evaluate hemorrhoid disease. I don't think they're quite as good at it as I am, but and I can do colonoscopies as well. And that's where I shine, is in the proctology part of it. So if you're concerned about hemorrhoids and you need a colonoscopy, if you see me for that, I'll make sure that you and I sit down and discuss your hemorrhoid problem. Yeah. So we can do that. Basically, how diet impacts whether you get hemorrhoids or not. Is that what you want to know? The importance of a high fiber diet. And that's what we all colorectal docs, a lot of the GI docs, we all speak in unison about high fiber. The heart docs, high fiber, everything is important. You know, it affects the heart. Fiber decreases your cholesterol. Metamucil actually will decrease your cholesterol, products like that. So diet is very important. And if you eat a proper diet with plenty of fiber, your stools will be easier to eliminate. There'll be less intracolonic pressure. There'll be less diverticulosis. And there'll be less trouble with hemorrhoids. So diet is critical. So that's a very, very good question. Other things in the diet that irritate you, alcohol. If you're a drinker, a lot of alcoholics or people that drink heavy have multiple bowel movements. That's very irritating. And a lot of them come in with hemorrhoids. Hot, spicy foods, especially cayenne pepper. I think most of you don't need me to tell you that it's irritating. But I like spicy food. I just deal with it. But again, look at your diet. Make sure you're drinking enough water. If you take fiber or fiber tablets or Metamucil or any of those products and you don't drink enough water, you're going to have an impaction. Got to drink water, especially in this heat. Okay, exercise is important as well, but make sure you drink your water. Yeah. Dried plums. Well, there's antioxidants, and I think plums, they work good. It's a good laxative too, isn't it? Yeah. Yeah, prunes are good, plums are good. Nothing wrong with that. Is this an outpatient procedure? Now you're talking about the Doppler-guided hemorrhoidal artery ligation, is that right? It's an outpatient procedure. Yes, indeed. Yes, yeah, sitz baths. The question is, are sitz baths indicated after rectal procedures? Yes, I almost always do that. Yes. Sitz baths are good, and I like a little Epsom salt in the bath. And you can use that as a primary treatment for your hemorrhoids as well. If you have prolapsing hemorrhoids, try sitz baths. That works. You have rectal irritation, try sitz baths. Very effective treatment. And it's been around for hundreds of years. So I endorse exercise. I would never say anything bad about exercise. It just keeps your body young, keeps you vigorous. And I think if you can do it, go for it.